Okay, well, good morning, everyone. We'll get started on the next session. So we're really pleased to have Martin here today this morning. So I'd just like to hand over the talk now to Martin Odersky, who's going to be talking about dots from dot and dot to Dotty. Thanks a lot, Martin.
Okay, thank you. And so what are the next steps for future Scala? And I believe that actually some of the lessons we've learned will influence programming languages as a whole. So Dot is essentially the foundations of what we've been working on, and Dotty is essentially a new prototype compiler and system for the next version of Scala. The background is that I think Scala is now 13 years old. It's about, its birthday is about now. So it's a teenager. It already had quite a big impact. I think it's fair to say that it has led the charge to bring functional programming into the mainstream. It has influenced a host of new languages, including Swift, Kotlin, Rust. If you look at the syntax and features of these languages, you see a clear lineage. Just to give you some perspective, when we came out in Scala, people said we were completely crazy to write name colon type. Nobody does that. Absolutely nobody. There would be no, every language writes type name, Java, C sharp, and things like that. And now if you see a lot of new languages coming out, and they all do it that way. So that's just one of the things that has happened there. Of course, a very superficial syntactic things. There are also other features like local type inference, pattern matching traits that have been adopted or are about to be adopted by established languages like Java or C sharp. And for us, of course, it meant that over these 13 years, it was very exciting times, and we've also learned a lot. So for us, the question was now, what's next? So what do we do with what we've learned? And that has led to essentially one step back, two step forward strategy. So the one step back was that we really felt the need to develop formal foundations to be sure what we do, because it turned out that if you look at, let's say, the world of academia, where people look at calculi and type systems, they look at very, very small languages, minimal languages, too small to be really used in industry. If you look at industrial languages, then those languages are huge compared to what the academics do, and they are on much shakier foundations. And that manifests itself in essentially occasionally you see, well, this and this feature of this and this programming language is in fact unsound, as was proven recently by one of my students and others, that null is unsound no matter whether you look at Java or at Scala. So once we are back on firm foundations, and I think we made good progress for that, we want to take two steps forward, which means we want to make the language both simpler and more powerful. Now, simpler has many meanings. There's a very good talk by Rich Hickey, which says simple is not easy, so it's not the same thing, so simple is not necessarily familiar. What I mean by simpler could also mean reduced in features, so that you can't do much with it, so you can't essentially shoot yourself in the foot. That's not what Scala is either. Scala is really simpler in the sense of having few orthogonal features. And it doesn't have that reputation. People think Scala is a very complex language, but the data don't back that up. So I just pulled some grammars from the web and just did a word count on it. So this is lines, this is tokens, this is words, and that's some of these languages. And here, I mean, I'm not claiming any sort of scientific accuracy here. I really copy-pasted, and I might have misrepresented by a couple of tens of percent. But you see the ballpark figure to say, well, Scala is actually not a big language. It's actually smaller than all of these languages here. And that's true, that it's not a big language because it has already very few but orthogonal features. The features it has are very powerful, so it makes Scala into a very powerful language, which means that people can do a lot of different things with it. So that means if you come new to Scala and you see programs written in lots of different styles, then yes, that's definitely the case. People do lots of different things with it. They write Scala in lots of different ways, but it doesn't mean that the language has a lot of different features. It has the same features that can be used for different things. Okay, so back to foundations. Why do they matter? So they help us ensure properties such as type soundness. I believe they also serve as a very useful feedback loop for language design. If we want the truly powerful features, then working on the foundations will help us to do that. They will help us essentially go deep and not stay at the surface. And that way, they also help detect hidden connections between language features, because you say, well, on a highly abstracted level, this feature and that feature, they're just two embodiments of the same principle. So why not pick existing foundations? There are quite a few. There's, for instance, the Lambda calculus for functional programming. There's Featherweight Java for Java, which essentially is this core subset of Java, which has been extended by many, many papers many, many different times. We didn't do that because if you pick existing foundations, then essentially you end up with just small variants of existing languages. Foundations are very, very formative. So once you take your foundation seriously, you're sort of forced with the language. So if you had taken Lambda calculus as a foundation, then maybe Scala would have been a strict Haskell. We wouldn't have done laziness, probably. And if you had picked FJ or something like that as a foundation, then maybe it would have been something like C#, a variant on Java. But it is neither of the two things. It's really something completely different. And because it's emphatically different, it's not Haskell, it's not Java, we need foundations that are also different, that are specific to what we do. And these foundations, essentially what they do is they mix objects and functions in a new, interesting way. So in particular, something what we wanted to express with foundations were objects and classes, but in a way seen as true modules. That means things that can abstract over types, and also type parameterizations. So our aim then, we wanted a minimal theory that can express type parameterization modules, objects, and classes. And there were several attempts before when we came out with Scala. Actually, we did one of these attempts. There was a paper on a calculus called New Object in ECOOP, the European Conference on Object-Oriented Languages, in 2003. That was the date. That was 1 year before Scala came out. But they were not, to be fair, really minimal. They were still complex, and there was sort of accidental complexity in these things. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to sort of distill it to the essence of what we do. And the essence, it turned out, the big part of the essence are dependent types. So dependent types have been very popular nowadays in more researchy languages such as Idris or Agda. They are discussed to be included in Haskell. Scala had them for a long time, but they had them in a restricted version. In particular, the version is called path-dependent types. So in Scala, we restrict dependencies to path, and in the calculus I'm going to show you, we restrict it further to variables. A path is just this thing here, so it's either a variable, an immutable variable you won't be able to assign to it, or you can select immutable fields from a path. So let's look at an example what that means. So here's a simple type of heterogeneous maps that you can write in Scala, could write forever, you don't need new foundations for that, but they just express what we want to do in sort of in a nutshell as a sort of lab experiment. So the idea here is that we have a trait heterogeneous map, where we have get and add methods, so to get from a key a value and to add, given a key, a value. But then, now the question is, what's the relationship between the key and the value? In a normal map, key is just a type, value is just a type. In this map here, the value should depend on the key. So an example here that you have here, for instance, we have a parameters, so that should be an empty HMAP, and then we want to add a width key with width 120 and a sort key with parameter time. So presumably that's essentially some sort of command line that we have expressed here. And that is type correct, but if we add another thing, let's say a width key with value true, that will give us a type error. To say width is it's an integer, it's not a Boolean. And we want to store these things in a map. So the map you see up here, and the trick is that the key type here is itself a trait that has a type field that's the value. So it says, well, that's the value for which this thing is a key. So here we create two new ones. So here's a sort key, where we say, well, for the sort key, the value is string, and for the width key, the value is int. And that's all that's needed. So these are these sort of dependent types, because it turned out, for instance, if you look here, the add value, that in order to add, given a key, the value must be of type key.value. So that's this form, key is the variable and value is the type. So the type now contains a reference to a term, to a value in the program. So that's what makes the type dependent, what we say about dependent types. Okay, cool. So that was just a simple example to get over to explain to you what this is in code. So if we want to distill all these ideas into a calculus, then we end up with something we call DOT, which DOT stands for dependent object types. So the type structure of this calculus is a blueprint also for the types we use internally in the compiler. So it's not just a theoretical exercise, but we take the types we've studied, and essentially those are the types that compiler is essentially computing with. So let's have a look what this DOT thing is. As I said, it's essentially a calculus can be thought of a minimal programming language. So the programming language fits on one page. It is you can treat it as a subset of Scala, a very small subset. So that's all there is in terms of expressions and terms. So you have values, and essentially a value, you have a function, a lambda, so those are values, and then you have objects, and here we don't even bother writing classes, they are essentially anonymous objects with where we just give you a bunch of definitions, and we also don't have any magic with this, so we let you declare this as a parameter with its own type, which actually you can do in Scala, so all this is actually legal Scala, but essentially reduced, very much reduced Scala, just like FJ is a very much reduced Java calculus. Okay, what's a definition? It's a method definition, no parameters, the parameters we have in the lambdas here already, so just def A equals T, or it's a type alias, type A equals T. And then finally, what's an expression? Well, it's one of these two values, or it's a variable, or it's an application of a lambda expression to an argument, or it's a selection, so you select a method in an object, or we have local definitions, so that would be just a val definition, and that would be followed by another expression. So that's the term language, very much reduced. What's a type language? That's essentially the core types that we need here in Scala. So the core types are, we have the types form a lattice, and there's a top element called any and a bottom element nothing, so we keep those in the calculus. We have type selection, so for instance, x.a, so that could be, for instance, scala.list, so the Scala package could be one of these x's, but it also could be a type like the value type you saw in the key type, so key.value. Or it will turn out that we can actually also model any form of generics and type parameterization with that trick. We have a function type. We have then essentially very simple object types, one for methods, which is just the structural type def a t, a single field. And the other one would be a record which has a type field. So that's sort of different from languages that just have normal records. Here the records have as fields as well as types, so term fields as well as type fields, and that makes essentially objects into modules, because modules want to essentially give you a bundle of things that consists of fields and methods and types, so abstract types, inner classes, and these sort of things. So we need to be able to talk about types as well as fields and methods. So that's the type thing. Those two things here, that's essentially, we can give a type a lower bound and an upper bound, which means that the type is now expected to be a supertype of T1 and a subtype of T2. You can leave out either one of those bounds, of course, and then if you leave out the lower bound, which is quite common, the lower bound is nothing. If you leave out the upper bound, then the upper bound is any. So these give you single element records, basically. Now you can compose them with an intersection operator. So that's the AND operator. Current Scala doesn't have the AND operator. It has a with, which is almost the same thing, but not quite. So that's one of the things that will change. The difference between the with in Scala and the AND that you see here is that the AND is true intersection, which means it's commutative. So T1 and T2 is the same as T2 and T1. For technical reason, that wasn't the case with the with. So that's why we decided that for the types, we will actually phase out with and introduce true intersection. And then finally, you have recursion, which that's a single feature that's very powerful on this level. That's actually not in current Scala, and we will not add it, but it's sort of, we have a special version of Scala that, we have a specialized instances of Scala, notably in refinement types, so they're just specialized versions of that. Okay, so that's basically what the calculus is about. Now, who here has a training in programming languages, so did some computer science or things like that? Okay, cool. Then let's just go into it and say, well, what do people do with that then? Well, first they turn things into Greek. So they don't do that, they do that. But it's the same thing. So it's essentially you have Greek letters, mu for a recursive type, the alpha for a dependent function type, intersection is with the and, the top and the bottom are with these turnstile symbols. Otherwise, it's the same thing. Okay. Then they have type assignment rules. Who has not seen such a rule before and wants me to explain it? I guess quite a few people. Okay, so type assignment rules is a way essentially mathematicians and logicians describe logic systems and essentially programming language theorists describe type systems. The way you read it is to say there's this line, horizontal line, and everything over the line is a precondition. So you say if that holds, then the postcondition holds. So let's just pick the first line here. So that says we have this gamma thing that's essentially a symbol table, or type theorists say environments. So that contains things like the assumptions that the variable x has a type t. So we say if variable x has type t is in gamma, then we can conclude, given an environment gamma, that x has type t. Yeah, big deal. So here's another one, which is more interesting, to say, well, if I want, well, maybe let me pick this one here. So we have a, x is a function type, so it's it says it goes from s to t, but there's this parameter z that makes the function dependent. And then we say, well, if the argument y has the type s, then x applied to y has the type t. Only we need the substitution here because the functions are dependent. That means we have to rename the formal parameter z by the actual argument y, because that's essentially what happens with the dependent functions that we've seen so far. And the other rules are similar. So here we have the rules for lambda abstraction application. Then we have rules for the objects. So that one is, again, a very simple rule, which says, well, let's say x has type a single element record A of type t. Then x dot A has type t, da, right? So that's pretty clear. And this one here says, well, that's essentially this object constructor, where we say, okay, let's construct an object with the definitions d, and let's call the self of the object, let's call it x, and let's have t as a type of this. And then we essentially package this all in a new. And then what we need to do is to say, well, assuming x, that this has type t, the definitions indeed have the type that this claims to have, then the whole thing is essentially one of these object types, one of these recursive types. Okay, I guess I'm going to skip over the rest. You can look up the rules. The slides are on SlideShare. And I'll also point you to a paper that explains these things in a lot more detail than I have time for the talk. Maybe just the last rule, which shows that we're really an object-oriented language, that's the so-called subsumption rule, which says, okay, if T has type T, and T is a subtype of U, then T also has type U. So that's essentially, you can say, the subtyping rule or Liskov substitution principle. It says, well, if something has a subtype, then we can pretend it also has a supertype. We can treat it as an instance of the supertype. Okay, so that's the type assignment rules. There's a small addition, so for when definitions have certain types, that we need three rules for that. And we need a couple of rules for subtyping. But these are, again, all very, very standard and very, very simple. So these rules on the left basically just say, well, if you have top, bottom, and intersection types, what are the subtype rules? And basically, you have no choice. Mathematics tells you what rules you have. And then on the right-hand side, in the right-hand columns, we have basically subtype rules for the types that we have. Okay, so let's say as a comparison to existing models, I think it's fair to claim that this one is very, very simple. So for what it does, it's actually not complex at all. To fit it into just these couple slides, and these are all the rules, I haven't hidden anything from you, is actually makes it a fairly simple system. But it's also expressive. So what it actually can do, and what the compiler uses it for, it can express generics, so type parameters, it can express variants, it can express nominal typing. So this is huge. Nominal typing is a thing. You haven't seen any classes or interfaces or these things. So nominal types mean normally, well, types are not defined by their structure, but by their name. But then I have to sort of work with a set of definitions to say, well, given the class point, say, well, here's what's in a point, and that's sort of a secondary thing. And once you add everything up, you get typically fairly complex type systems. Whereas in this system, we don't do that, and it turns out that the nominality, the idea that you want to have named things and types have names and are defined by their names, can be recovered purely by the abstract types that you saw. Okay, we can do generative modules. We can do self-types, we can do ADTs and simple classes. We can't do inheritance directly, so that would need a smallish extension, but it turns out inheritance is mostly a code saver, right? So it's mostly something where you just save on duplication, so you can treat that sort of orthogonal to the rest. So things should be easy and simple, right? But it turns out they were not. So the soundness proof, so what theorists then go to say, essentially, they want a statement. They want to say, okay, we have these typing rules that give you a program in your calculus, that give a type. Does the type mean anything? So what could it mean? So basically, one thing you want to establish is essentially, well-typed programs do not go wrong. That's the slogan. That means, well, if it has a type, then it will reduce. Well, it might still loop, but let's say it doesn't loop, it reduces to a value, then that value will have exactly the same type as the type the program predicts. So if I say an expression has type string, then I won't have the situation where when I evaluate that expression, I end up with an int, right? So that would be obviously wrong, then the type would be worth nothing. And that's essentially the formal statement I want to do. It's called type soundness, and we tried since 2008 to prove it correct. And we had a lot of failures on the way. So I just want to give you a quick indication of what we did and why it's hard. So the hard part is that in the small as the language is, it contains one feature which is very powerful from and problematic from a soundness perspective, and that was this thing here. So we have a type that has a subtype and a supertype. So that makes T a supertype of S and a subtype of U. Now, subtyping is transitive. So subtyping is a transitive relation. So if T is a supertype of S and a subtype of U, then if we're not very careful, we have just introduced essentially a new relationship that S is a subtype of U. Okay. But what if it wasn't? Let's say we have something like this. We just write T is a supertype of any, the top type, and a subtype of nothing. Just write it. Then by the same argument as before, by transitivity, what we get is any is a subtype of nothing. And that's essentially, since I'm here at CERN, the black hole of type theories, essentially the whole subtyping relationship shrinks to a single point and no light can escape anymore. So that's sort of the case, the end of all things, if you do that. And in particular, it's the end of type soundness, because once that's the case, you can't prove anything anymore about your program. So the problem is that we get a soundness failure. So you could say, well, maybe we should avoid that. We shouldn't let you write any of these things. We should let you write a type T with a subtype and a supertype only if we know that the subtype is in fact the lower bound is a subtype of the upper bound. If you know that a priori already, that's what we tried for a long time. And it turns out there are always situations where you can't. That's sort of like this thing to try to confine a balloon to a smaller and smaller place. Something will always pop out. And Scala is not alone in that space. Previously, it was shown the type unsoundness results for Java have to do essentially with a combination of null and wildcard types. So even in Java, which has a much more restricted type system, you can't ensure with wildcards that the lower bound is always a subtype of the upper bound. You can't. So that's the hard part of it. And the observation that we made in the end is to prove type soundness, we need to reason only about actual values. When we have essentially a type, and it's a type that sits in an object, then in the end we need to care only about the object that somebody constructed for us. Because when somebody constructs an object, then at that point we know we can't construct an object with essentially unsatisfiable types. We need to give a type, a concrete instance type for this. At this point we know that everything is okay. And the tricky part of the proof was to make use of that observation so that we can essentially transmit that knowledge everywhere it's used in the proofs. So for details, you see there was a paper in Phil Wattler's Festschrift last year. It's called The Essence of Dependent Object Types, and it's in that book here. Okay, so the interesting bit about this for language design is then to say, well, what can we learn of it for language design? So the meta theory has taught us this principle, that we say, if we have a type selection p.a, then p must come from a value we have already computed, because only for that value we know it has consistent bounds. And that's not always the case, so we have to be very careful in the programming language that this is the case. So let's have a look at some of the problems that we could have. Let's construct one of these bad bounds types. So this type A, is a subtype of any, a supertype of any and subtype of nothing. So, okay, so we can write it, but the problem is when we want to select on type A, is the prefix always a computed value? So here's the first problem. We have lazy values in Scala. So that means that we can actually write x.a without ever having computed x, because it's lazy. So lazy means it's only computed on demand, but just taking the type from it is not a demand. That's just talking about the type of this lazy thing. So the lazy thing will be computed only when somebody actually needs it. So here I've done essentially this triple question mark, that's the right-hand side, that's actually legal Scala, it's just a symbolic name like many others. Its type is bottom, its type is nothing. So it's just an infinite, it just throws an exception, unimplemented, right? So here I say, well, okay, if you ever bother to evaluate lazy, you'll get unimplemented. But what if nobody ever essentially selects references this thing, but we still talk about the type? Then we are stuck. Then we have a type soundness problem. So we can't do that. So we need to drastically restrict types we can write in a lazy val. That one we already knew in current Scala, but there's more to come. So the next thing is in Scala we actually have a hash operator which says the prefix of this thing can not only be a value, but it also can be a type. That's very similar to Java inner classes. You can write outer class dot inner class. In Scala, we write outer class hash inner class, but it's really the same thing. It turns out in Java, that's actually not a problem because outer class is concrete enough that we can't do anything bad with it. But in Scala, the current rules were more lenient than that, and people have used that for all sorts of crazy things, including writing lambda calculus in Scala's type system using SKK combinators and things like that. So we can't do that anymore because bad bounds is not a value. So just writing the type here means it could be inconsistent. So that's the next thing that we will remove. That's already done in the current Dotty repo. That's already removed. Okay. The next thing is null. So we could write valx bad bounds equals null. And null is not a value. Just having null doesn't mean that the type is consistent, right? And that's essentially the type soundness bug that I referred to several times, both in Scala and in Java. So that means we have to track null in the type system, which it turns out with the types we have now in Scala, in particular union types, is actually pretty straightforward. But there's another thing which is much harder, that we also need to track initialization status. That means that we could actually not use null at all, but as a name, but we could essentially rely on the fact that objects are pre-initialized, all fields are pre-initialized to null, and then sneakily essentially get this thing. So that's still an open question, how we're going to tackle that. Okay, so that just shows essentially what we did with foundations and how foundations can actually influence language design in quite interesting and profound ways. I want to spend the rest of my talk to talk a little bit about one specific feature in the new compiler and in the new language. So a new compiler is called Dotty, that's the working name of the Scala compiler, builds on Dot in its internal structures. For instance, generics, type parameters actually get expressed as these type members that you've seen, and it will support the next iterations of the Scala programming language. So what do I see essentially as the big interesting new developments? There's several, but here I just want to do one specific, which I think if I should pick one, then I'm most excited about that one. And that one is called implicit function types. So implicit function types, what are they? So the commit message said it's the first step to bring contextual abstraction to Scala. Contextual abstraction, what is that? So the idea is, well, let's have a look first at what is a context. A context is essentially everything that's not in the text, but that's needed to understand the text, right? So that's the meaning of context. So it comprises all the input that let a program do its work, including things like configuration data, capabilities, dependency injection, type class instances if you look at Haskell, or essentially implicits in Scala that do the same thing. And in Scala, we have a way, a recommended way to treat all these things, these contextual notions, these contextual constructs, and that's called implicit parameters. So it's a technique of choice to pass input to program parts that need them. An implicit parameter is basically just like a normal parameter, but you don't write it. You don't pass the parameter explicitly to the function. Instead, it will be selected based on the type. So the function says, I need an implicit parameter of type context. And you have one in scope, which also has to be labeled implicit to be eligible. Then the compiler will actually do the plumbing to you to pass this context everywhere down you need it. But there's one problem with it, and that's essentially we still need to declare them on each function that needs them. So it's not completely boilerplate free. We make it very easy for the actual arguments, but for the definitions, there's still an overhead to write them. So let's look at an example where we use these implicit parameters. The example could be anything, but I've just picked transaction handling. So let's suppose we have a class transaction here. And this one is pretty simple. So essentially, it lets you print in a transaction. And printing just means appending the given string to the log. And then you can abort the transaction, and you can commit it. And if you can commit it, if it's not aborted before, then you print the log that you store here to the console. So now, essentially, the transaction has committed. It does the things in an irreversible manner, and that's it. So it's just essentially to fit on one slide a very simple transaction. So here we have a somewhat synthetic example. So we have three functions, f1, f2, f3, and they both take an int, and they do essentially some computation on, and then call the next function, and they essentially print the current value of x, their parameters, to the transaction log. So they print the x value here in these three statements. And to be able to print it on the transaction log, they need to know what the current transaction is. So that transaction is being passed down to all of the functions as an implicit parameter. I could make it an explicit parameter, of course, but then I would have had to pass current along the call paths in each of these these recursive calls, in each of these nested calls, I would have to pass current along. And the fact that current is implicit means the compiler will do that for me, because it will say, OK, here F1 calls F2. F2 needs a transaction, an implicit transaction value. Do I have one? Yeah, of course, it's here. It's right here as a parameter. So that's the one I will pass along. And if it's ambiguous, then the compiler will tell me it's ambiguous, and you have to essentially do it explicitly. OK, so here's the main program then. So that's my main function. And here I say, well, run this thing in a transaction, in a transactional context. So that thing would compute the first function F1, which in turn calls F2, F3. And then essentially it just tells me what the status was. It's if it was aborted, it prints aborted. Otherwise, it prints the result. And the transaction outer function here, well, that's just the thing. Well, what should it take? It needs a lambda. So it takes a function from transaction to T. And what it does is it builds a new transaction in trans. It invokes the operation, that's the thing between the braces here, with the new transaction it has built as a parameter. And at the end, it commits the transaction. And that's just a simple example run of what this thing do. OK, so that's what's done, what would be essentially the recommended way probably to do it in current Scala. Can we do better? So one problem here is that we have this boilerplate code for declaring the implicit parameters. All three functions had this parameter section implicit, current, or this transaction of type transaction. Repeating it three times doesn't look so terrible. But if we look, let's say, at the Dotty compiler itself, then the Dotty compiler has 2,641, at the time I wrote the slide, occurrences of implicit CTX context, because context is a thing that's basically passed down into almost every function in the compiler. So 2,641 repetition, that sounds like something that would profit from a language feature, that you could avoid that. That's getting somewhat heavy. So we'd like to get rid of these things. So how would we do that? Well, let's massage to essentially develop a solution pedagogically. Let's massage the solution of the definition of F1 a little bit. So F1, that was this one here, right? That one here. So it takes a first parameter X, then in a second parameter list, it takes the transaction. And essentially what we do is we just move it to the right. We just say, OK, we all know that we can essentially move parameters from the method to the lambda. So we make it a lambda on the right-hand side. And says F1 essentially is a lambda. It takes an implicit transaction, and then it prints the thing. OK, so the right-hand side of this function is now an implicit function value. What's its type? So the type so far in current Scala is transaction to int. So that's the thing that gets returned to it. What I propose with implicit function types is to have a type that says implicit transaction to int. So essentially, not to lose this idea that the parameter is implicit. Previously, we just essentially, in the type, we forgot about implicitness. Now we said, let's put it in the type. Or desugared functions are, as we know, function types in Scala desugar into class types, object types, like everything else. For the implicit function, that would be its desugaring. So it would be an implicit function one with two parameters, transaction and int. And implicit function one, that's just essentially a new type, a standard type in the library. It's a subtype of function one, so implicit functions are functions. And it has an apply method, just like function one. And the only difference is, well, the apply takes an implicit parameter, not a normal one. And that I've shown you the thing for one, so we can do the same thing for two, three, four, and all the other arities. OK. So, good. So far, that's the types. What are the typing rules? What rules do we need? Surprisingly, we don't need a lot of them. We need two of them, to be exact. So the first rule says that if we have an implicit function, then we pass implicit arguments to it, just like for normal implicits. So we have this f, which is an implicit function type, from A to B, and we have an implicit in scope of type A, then just writing f expands to f of A. Just as if f had been a method that takes an implicit a parameter. So it doesn't matter whether it's a method or a value of a function type. It's completely analogous. So we pass the a. And the second rule is that if the implicit functions get created on demand. If the expected type of some expression B is implicit A to B, so we have a B of type B and we need an implicit A to B, then the compiler will expand this to essentially an implicit function of an unnamed argument. I could use anything, but so I just write this underscore of type A to B. That's all. That's the two rules that I have. Okay, so let's see how this would work in our revised example. So what I do now is to say, let's define a new type, call it transactional. Transactional of T is an implicit function from transaction to T. And now my F1, F2, F3, they don't have implicit parameters anymore. They have a result type that says it's a transactional of int. So all these three functions says, well, they have to be run in a transaction context. That's what the type transactional of x means. And otherwise, they would have the same text as before. Okay, so there's one question. The current, this thing here, that was the implicit parameter name before. So now, where does it come from? So current is not bound, is it? So what we need to do is, we need to write it like this. We need to write a definition current, which is a transactional of transaction. And what it does is, it says, well, give me a transaction, the current transaction, and I'll just give it back to you. And it says, well, I make it explicit. That's my current transaction. And that's done with this implicitly function, which is in the Scala standard library. Implicitly function is a super simple function. It just says, give me an implicit x and I'll give it back to you. So it's the identity on the implicit thing. Okay, so that's what current does. And that means we can now, if we look at the other things we do, so main, we call transaction. And we don't need an implicit context anymore. That's just provided indirectly. And transaction here takes a transactional of T, and otherwise it has the same implementation as before. Okay, you could say, well, one possible objection to all this. So what we have achieved is essentially we have sort of done the same thing that we can do in Java to EE with essentially annotations and things like that to say, well, this thing runs in a transactional context. Don't bother me with the details. That's precisely what we have done here through the implicit function types. You could say, well, what about efficiency? Because, well, we have all these lambdas, and now every function here, where do we have it? Yeah, here. It essentially builds a closure, and then we call it. It actually turns out that, A, it's not so bad. So in some examples we ran, we got a slowdown of maybe 50% in essentially very heavily transaction code. Not that bad. B, it can actually be optimized away to be zero, and that's what we do. So what we do is, if we have the situation that a function essentially it has a normal parameter block and then it has an implicit closure on the right-hand side, then we just rewrite it into a current function. So basically we would now have two heads, one is that, the second one is this one here, and that means that we can sort of short-circuit, that we don't really have to construct the closure, we can just use this function here and pass the implicit as a parameter as we did before. So that brings the cost of implicit functions down to zero, compared to implicit parameters that we have so far. Okay, so maybe just giving you a single example, transaction doesn't make you that much excited, but the thing is that was essentially an example that I wanted to work through so that one understands all the elements of it. There's actually much more to that. You can do a lot of very, very interesting things. So I want to do one more just to show what you could do with it, and that's a builder pattern. So the builder pattern has been popularized, I think, by Groovy. I'm not sure, maybe Ruby has it as well. I wouldn't be surprised. It's a neat way to define structure building DSLs. So you can write table, and then in the braces you can write row, and then in the row you can write cells, and well, you get what it looks like. You get a two-dimensional table with rows and cells. So indirectly, what these things do is essentially row essentially adds itself to the table and cell adds itself to the enclosing row by a side effect. But in order to do that, they must know what the enclosing table and row is. So it's natively supported in Groovy, and it's also supported in Kotlin via receiver functions, which is sort of a fancy way to redefine what this in a function means. So there was Li Hao Yi that challenged me and says, with your newfangled implicit function types, maybe you should have receiver functions, a great feature of Kotlin. And I looked at it, and I looked at the examples, and said, well, can we do it with implicit function types? And it turns out, yes, you can. So here's how you do it. So we have to define these three methods, table, row, and cell. So let's have a look at, maybe let's take it from the bottom. So cell is just a simple definition which essentially builds a new cell, a cell class, which I haven't shown you here. And it has to add the cell class to the enclosing row. So it writes R add new cell string. So where does R come from? Well, that should be an implicit parameter row. So we pass R as an implicit parameter to the cell so that the cell knows to which row it should add itself. So one level up, row now. What we have row, we have essentially the same thing. We essentially have to add row to an implicit table, so that's the same thing. But we have to do more. We have to essentially, once we define a row, row has to tell all the enclosing cells, well, I'm the row you should add yourself to, right? So what the way we do that is we define the row first as an implicit value, then we call init. Init is essentially the block that takes the row. So that's essentially that thing here, the thing in braces. That's the init block. So we run this init block with, essentially because it's an implicit function from row to unit, with the current row as the parameter. And then once we've done that and added all the cells, we add ourselves to the table. And table does the same thing. So it just essentially creates a new table, runs init, which will cause all the rows to add themselves to the table, and returns the table. So the claim I want to make here, without a formal proof, but the claim is that any situation where an entity is implicitly understood can be expressed with implicit function types. We've seen the current transaction, the structure to which current code should be added, and there are many, many other possibilities. For instance, the current configuration, something we use essentially dependency injection or something like that for, the capabilities to run this code, I think that can revolutionize ways we do security management, or the effects this code has on the outside world. So that I just leave you with that sort of future work to reclaim that effects actually can also be described with these sorts of capabilities and contexts. So in summary, implicit function types are a really neat way to abstract over contexts, a very powerful feature because they allow one to inject implicit values in a scope simply by defining a type. And I expect that they will quite fundamentally affect the kind of code we will write in Scala and maybe in other programming languages in the future as well. To finish, just when can I expect all this? So what I was talking about was really the right column here. That's from Dot to Dotty, what we've been working on. Mainstream Scala is essentially on the left column. So that's 2.12 out now. 2.13 will be out next year. We're currently working on the main feature of 2.13. That's essentially a redesign of the standard library collections, and that feature will already go into 2.13 as well as into the Dotty 0.x releases. We're working on essentially a first Dotty release that should be out sometimes this spring, or that will be sort of the minimal viable prototype for Dotty, and then we are going to work on a set of releases in the future, where in the end we expect that this will lead to Scala 3.0, and concurrently with Scala 3.0 there will be a version 2.14, which should be the terminal version of the 2 series, and 2.14 will be mostly focus on interoperability, so essentially how can we migrate code to the next version of Scala. This whole thing has been done with lots and lots of people, lots of contributors. I won't have time to name all their names, they're on the slides. And if you want to find out more about implicit function types specifically, go to onscalalang.org on the blog. I wrote a blog there that explains that in detail. So if the talk was a bit fast to you now, you can read it up here. Thank you.